name, O Lord. For our God is great. How great is our God. When the angels look at him, all they can sing is, holy, holy, holy. All of creation. We humble ourselves tonight. We bless your name tonight. Hallelujah. We bless your name. We bless your name. We bless your name. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. While we are still standing and we are worshiping, why not just lift up your hands and say, Lord, you are indeed holy. You are indeed worthy. The Lamb that is worthy. Hallelujah. We glorify your name tonight. We exalt your mighty name. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord, God Almighty. Hallelujah. I'll ask Pastor Lewis to come and just pray with us tonight. Hallelujah. He is worthy. I say he is worthy. He is worthy.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Tonight we worship your name. We worship your presence. We thank you, Lord, for tonight's presence in our life, in our hearts. Not because we are only in this house, because your presence lives in our life, in our hearts. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on, people. Hallelujah. Oh, oh, oh. Yes, sir. Your presence tonight, God. Hallelujah. We call you Abba. We call you Abba. Abba, Father.
Father, we bless your name. Father, we bless your name. Oh, Father, we come to this place, oh Lord, seeking nothing else, oh Lord, but to bless your presence. Lord, we worship you. We worship you, and we declare, oh Lord, that you are holy. Presence of the living God. Father, we seek you. We seek you. We seek you. We seek you, Father. Inside of us there is a need. There is a need. There is a need. And there is a hunger that only you can fill. There is a hunger that only you can fill. There is a hunger that only you can fill. Oh, Holy Spirit. We seek your presence, Lord. We seek your presence. We seek your presence. Lord, this is a time that you have set apart, that you have called revival. We have a need. We have a need. We have a need. Holy Spirit, we have a need of you. We have a need of you. We have a need of you. Only you can fill us, Lord. Only you can satisfy.
Thank you, Jesus, because tonight we're expecting great things from you. Talk to us. Touch us. Give us an opportunity to see you more than our expectations, God. Give us the opportunity tonight, even children's, to see you, God, in the name of Jesus.
Amen. You can be seated. A special special good night to each and every one of you, and welcome to our revival weekend. We have planned it, we have prayed about it, and tonight we will believe God. Amen? Don't be discouraged with the amount of people. God is able to do great and mighty things. Amen? I know for sure, I am believing God that He will do great and mighty things. Amen? So I want you to receive from the Lord. Open up your hearts and ready. Amen? Tonight we want to give enough time to the servant of the Lord. He has traveled all the way from South Africa to be with us. And Pastor Sonny will come in a few minutes and introduce him. But before we do that, we want to stand and we want to give unto the Lord tonight. Can we do that? Amen. Let's all stand together as we give the Lord a hand of praise and as we get ready to give unto Him. Amen.
He can do it again. I said He can do it again. You believe that? That's the title of my song.
You may be down and feel like God had somehow forgotten that you are faced with circumstances you can't get through. Sometimes it feels there's no way out and you're going under. But God's proven time He'll take care of you, and He'll do it again. If you just take a look at where you are now and where you've been, haven't He always come true? And He knows how you're hurting. You see, He knows just how your heart has been broken in two. But He's the God of the stars, the sun and the sea, and He is your Father. If He can calm the storm, find some way to fix it for you, and He'll do it again.
Oh, He will do it again.
He wants to do it again.
Yes, He'll do it again.
If you just take a look at where you are now,
where you are now.
And where
Lord, tonight we believe you that you are able to do it again. Lord, tonight we believe you that you will revive us. You'll bring deliverance. You'll bring healing. You will set the captives free. In the name of Jesus, we declare it tonight in our midst. We declare, oh God, that healing will come. Deliverance will come. Touch your people again. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Lord, we thank you for the offering. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You can be seated. And let's put our hands together as Pastor Sonny comes and as he welcomes our visiting speaker for tonight. Can we give him a hand? Amen.
Amen. Good to see all of you here on a Friday night. Amen. Back in June, we decided to do a revival weekend, exactly these 2 days, today and tomorrow. And at that time, we had no idea who's going to come and preach to us. But by faith, we set apart this weekend as a revival time. And we started praying about it. And within a few days, my good friend, our speaker for tonight and tomorrow, Pastor Paul Pillay from South Africa, contacted me and told me that he is coming this way during this month. So I realized immediately that it's more than a coincidence. It was God's doing. And it was God's timing. Amen. Because we had already set apart this weekend. So right away I contacted him and said that we have set apart this weekend. And I believe God is sending you here for a purpose. Amen. And he agreed to come and be with us this weekend. Since then, some of his programs got changed, but nonetheless, he kept his word. And I am so delighted that he is here with us. I had the privilege to be in his church about 5 years ago. He is the senior pastor of a church in the suburbs of Durban, South Africa, called Chatsworth. And he has about 500 plus members in his church. And the name of his church is Nazareth Family Church. And a very dynamic, enthusiastic a bunch of people. What stick with me from my visit to his church is that how enthusiastically they got into the worship. You know, a very pleasantly lively atmosphere in that church. And I was really, really blessed by being with them during that trip. And throughout South Africa, you will see a lot of lively churches. I don't have time to talk about that. God took me there for the first time in 1998 when I did not know anyone. Out of the blue, I got an invitation to go and preach in a crusade, gospel crusade, and I went not knowing what I'm going to do there. But when I landed there, to my surprise, I found hundreds and hundreds of thriving churches there. And I was very pleasantly surprised, really blessed by these precious brothers and sisters in the Lord there. Actually, they changed my outlook towards ministry a lot because I came from a certain background, and it was my close contact with my friends in South Africa that opened my mind to look at things in a different way, because they were very contemporary in terms of ministry and what God is doing in the kingdom, and always, you know, keep the pulse of what God is doing today. They are not stuck what God did 50 years ago or 100 years ago. That's a big difference I saw in the churches in South Africa. They always want to know, what is God doing today? And they try to stay with that. And if you do that, if you have a commitment like that, then you have to be dynamic. You cannot sit back and relax. And I really enjoy the company and friendship of this group of Christians way down there. And I'm very delighted to have Pastor Paul here tonight. 4 years ago, he was in this church one Sunday morning ministering to us when we did an international conference, leadership conference here called the Gonsal Conference. And he came as one of the delegates for that conference. And one Sunday he ministered here. And I still, not only me, many people in this church still remember even the message that he preached that day. So that's how powerful his ministry was here 4 years ago when he visited. That's why I was so excited when he agreed to come. We all know that today is Friday. It's a working day. Not everyone can be here. But I'm glad all of you are here. And tomorrow we'll have a much bigger crowd. Amen. So without any further ado, let's put our hands together and welcome Pastor Paul Pillay.
God bless you. Hello. Is the church here? Is the church here tonight? Tell your neighbor it's Friday night. No, don't tell me. Tell your neighbor. Tell your neighbor it's Friday night and everything's going to be all right. How many of you believe that? Come on, how many of you believe that? No, come on, how many of you believe that? Come on, you asked for revival. No, I've come from Durban. I've traveled almost 20 hours to be here, 20 hours via Dubai, and I'm here, and I'm fresh, and I'm ready. Are you ready? Come on, are you ready for it? Well, let's turn to the book, the Word of God. Tonight I want to lay a foundation for you and trust that God will cause us by Sunday morning to come into understanding what God wants to do in this house. I believe God has a word for the house. How many of you believe that? I believe God has a word for this house. Amen. You believe that? Okay, let's turn to Mark chapter number 5. Okay, let's go to Mark chapter number 4. We'll take it from Mark chapter 4. Verse number 23. I want to lay a strong foundation, and then by tomorrow, we'll see where the Lord leads us. But God can do some crazy things tonight. We serve a crazy God. Hey, come on, God can do some radical things in the house. How many of you are expecting tonight? Amen, amen. Well, my wife is busy praying for you, and it's 3 o'clock in the morning in Durban. Everyone is asleep, but she's awake praying for this meeting and that God will give you a right word tonight. So Mark chapter 4, verse number 23. I want to thank my friend, Bishop Dr. Sonny Phillips, and his dear wife, Mercy, for allowing me this privilege to be here. You guys are privileged because I've come all the way just to honor the word that I've given to him because I said I'm coming. And then plans had changed. We just bought a property in Chatsworth worth a lot of money for a very good price. But God supernaturally came through for us. And I didn't want to leave the country because of the property, but I had to leave because of my word that I gave to your pastor. Come on, you got to honor your word. When you say you're coming, you got to come. Let your yea be yea and your nay be nay. You got to keep your word. Mark chapter 4, verse 23. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And he said unto him, take heed what you hear. With what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you. And unto you that hear shall more be given. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And he said unto them, take heed what you hear. With what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you. And unto you that hear shall more be given. That means all of us are hearing me today. But not everybody is understanding me. So he says, to you that have ears to hear, let him hear, and more will be given to the ones who hear. Faith comes by hearing. So everybody hears the word of God, but not everybody hears the word of God. Okay, you got to catch me quickly. So everybody hears the word, and not everybody understands the word. The word hearing there is the word understanding. So he says, to those that get understanding, more will be given to you so that more understanding may come to you. He says, I can't give you any more than you already have because if you don't have understanding of what I've given to you, I can't give you more revelation of what I want to give you. So he says, to those that have ears, let them hear. And to those that have caught what has been said, I'll give you more. So God can't give you more revelation, and the word yeah there is understanding. He says, I want to give you understanding of this. So look at Mark chapter 7, verse number 13. It says, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, and which you have delivered, and many such like things do you. He says that the word of God has the power to change your life. He says the word of God has the capacity to alter your values. The word of God has the power to change the course of your destiny. But he says, you've made the word of God of none effect through your tradition. Now, the word tradition there is your understanding. He says, because you've taken the word of God that has the power to affect your life, and you've caused it to become so traditionalized that it has lost its effect in your life. So he can't give you revelation because you've traditionalized the word. You've taken the word and made it as if it's something that you have to do or something that you have to read, not getting understanding of it, not getting the light of it. Now you'll find out that God takes us to a man called Abraham, Genesis chapter 12. Let's turn there quickly. I want to build a strong foundation for you, and Bishop, through your permission, by Sunday morning we'll tie this whole thing up. So don't miss, tell your neighbor, don't miss these things. Now come on, tell your neighbor, don't miss these things. Amen. Now the Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show you. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a... Come on, talk to me. And thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that, and curse them that, and in thee shall all of thee, not even, all families of thee be. So where are you? In heaven? No, where are you? Where's my family? They're back in Durban, but they're in the... Come on, you got to catch me now. So that affects you. Does that scripture affect you? It's talking about you and I. He says, through Abraham, all families of the earth are going to be blessed. Then he says to Abraham, and those that bless you, I will bless them. Now, who's talking here? God is talking. God is talking to Abraham. He says, those who bless, I'll bless them. And those who curse, I'll curse them. So Abraham has to walk the promise of God, understanding the principle that our people deal with him, God's going to deal with them. You got to catch this. So Abraham walks the earth with this concept. How you treat me, God's going to treat you. So the principle that Abraham operates in is the principle of the power of peace. Now, what the church has lost is the power of peace. Peace tells me that I may have lots of people against me, but I don't have to be against them. Peace tells me that you may have me as an enemy, but I don't have to have you as an enemy. So the power of peace tells me that whatever you do unto me, God's going to do unto. So how you treat, because this affects all families of the. And I think the church has lost the connectivity as to how this covenant has really affected the life of believers. Now in the book of Genesis, we have the Edenic covenant. The Edenic covenant is God's covenant between heaven and the earth. God builds a garden and he plants it, the Bible says, eastward in Eden. Eastward speaks, or the significance of eastward is that the sun rises in the east. Come on now. And eastward speaks of a new day. Speaks of a new day. So when God plants a garden in eastward, the eastward is speaking of a new day. The Garden of Eden is a replica of heaven. Because as it is there, so shall it be here. So God makes the heaven and the earth a reflection of each other. And then he creates man. He says, you shall be a reflection of me. Man is created in the image of God. So when we understand that Abraham now has come onto the scene, we got to understand, how did he get on the scene? Where did he come from? How did he end up being the one that's going to give us the covenant? And that through him, all the families of the earth are going to be blessed. Because we can read the scripture and just read it without understanding, because we can read it because of our tradition to read it and not get proper basis and understanding of it. So God has to show us, through his word, how did he get to Abraham? To understand how he got to Abraham, you got to backtrack. You got to go to Babel. Because Abraham is part of Babel. They're building a tower, Genesis 11, who stopped me reach into heaven so that they'll make a name for themselves. But God comes to Genesis chapter 12 and he says to Abraham, I will make your name great. But we find that in chapter 11, they're building a tower whose top may reach into heaven that their names will not be forgotten. So they're trying to make themselves great. You find the scripture tells us that Jesus walks the earth and he tells his disciples, follow me and I will make you. Because you and I realize that we can't make ourselves anything unless God makes us something. So we understand that we can't start at Babel because that's not where it started. Can I say you this at the outset, that God doesn't have a plan B? You and I have a plan B because we know we operate by fear and doubt and not total faith. The Bible tells us in James chapter 2 that Abraham believed God and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Abraham believed God and he was a friend of God. I heard you singing that song while I was in the room, they're confirming what I needed to preach to you. So the convener didn't even know what God was talking to me about while he was preparing that song. God is not fazed and God is not moved when something happens on the earth. He knows everything. By the way, let me tell you who your God is. Your God is awesome. I think you guys take the word awesome too lightly here in the States. Because David had no words to describe God. He said, you're awesome. And we think awesome is just one of the words we could just use to describe God. In fact, David couldn't find a word. And he said, you're awesome. Tell your neighbor, God is awesome. Come on, tell your neighbor, God is awesome. Tell your neighbor, you may be cool, but God is awesome. You got to understand this awesome God. Now, let me tell you about this awesome God. He doesn't Google you to find out about you. God doesn't have to search the net to check your background. He can't help but know about you. God is not sitting there counting the number of sparrows falling to the ground. He's God. He sits on the throne. He knows everything. He's awesome. Come on. God is not checking your airbrush in the morning to check how many air you lost so that he can tell you how many air you got left. No, God is awesome. He can't help but know because he knows. God is awesome. And I think we're putting God in a category. God doesn't come to the end of conclusions. God doesn't draw statistics. He's awesome. He knows. He can't help but. So we've got to put God. When the convener, our gentleman, was talking about the angels saying, holy, 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 that's not the only thing you're going to do in heaven. If that's what they're going to do, I don't want to go there. If that's what they're going to do in heaven, I don't want to go there. So we're going to understand why the angels saying, holy, holy, holy. Because what happens is the angels see different facets of God. And every different facet they see, they can't help but say holy unto him because he's holy. He's awesome. Come on. He's holy. He's awesome. So every time they see God show up in a different facet, they've got to scream holy unto him. That's why you can only experience God in the facet you're experiencing it because you put him in a category. We've limited God. We put him into a category as to what we understand about God. See, you may come to the saving knowledge of Christ through salvation, maybe because you needed a healing or maybe you needed a miracle. But unless you walk with God, you'll find out the different facets of God, or else you'll only know him as the miracle worker, or only as the healer, or maybe only as the deliverer. But when you walk with God, you find out the different facets of God, and that's why the angels can't stop by saying, holy, 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 because every time they see God, they see a different facet of him, and they keep screaming, holy, because God is not just holy, he's righteous, he's holy, he's mighty, he's awesome. He's like no other. So Arnold Schwarzenegger might come to the end of his energy level, but God doesn't come to the end of his energy level. See, we draw conclusions. We come to the end of stuff. God is the same at the end as he was at the beginning. The Bible says that after 7 days, God rested. God didn't rest because he was tired. He rested because he was finished. You'll catch that during Christmas or Thanksgiving. You got to understand this. this God that you serve. God is not going to be short of $1,000 because somebody cried to God for $1,000 and God blessed them, and now you think he's $1,000 short. God does, come on, God is awesome, man. You got to catch this thing. In order to get this revival that's going to sweep you this weekend, you got to understand that God is awesome. You can't put him in a category. What you think of him is beyond your measure. In fact, I spent 3 years studying about this God in the university in Durban, South Africa, and I still can't find out who this God is. The more I try to find out who he is, the more I realize I don't know. Because you can't put him in a category. Come on, God is beyond your limits. God is beyond your boundaries. And we've set parameters and we've set limitations based on our own mechanism. Based on our own rule of measure. We've got to understand God is beyond understanding. God is beyond reason. He says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. Because I think differently, therefore I act differently. You can't categorize me. So when we understand where Abraham is in Babel. What are they doing? Trying to reach God. I think if the church can catch the concept of Genesis 11:6, we'll change the course of this earth. Look at Genesis 11:6. I'll show you something there. If the church can only get this, we'll have so many visions that are in churches that are not. And the Lord, who said? And the Lord, come on, who said? Who said? What did he say? Come on, let's go. That's a New King James Version. If you go the KJV, it tells you nothing they imagine in their heart to do will be restrained from them. That means if we can get the church to be one together and speak one language, nothing will be restrained. Who is saying this? He's saying, hold on. Babel got, they got the concept, they got the principle, but they're doing the wrong thing. He says they got the unity, they speak in the same language, but this is not what I wanted them to do. I think the greatest fear in life that I have is doing the wrong thing and having success. Because lots of people can do the wrong thing and get be successful doing the wrong thing. I think that's the greatest fear that I have. Is being successful doing the wrong thing. And God had to come there. He says, if the church can catch that concept, my God, we'll take the city. We'll take the city. We'll take the whole state. Nothing will be able to stand against us. Imagine if families can have that. If every family can get that. One language, unity, and nothing will be restrained. Show me a family that's divided. I'll show you a family that has no vision being fulfilled. Because when we can come to a place of unity and oneness, then it's easier to reach the goal. So where Abraham is in Babel. Babel means to babble, to speak. And what are they doing? They're trying to build a tower whose top may reach. Now, who started Babel? The Bible talks about a man named Nimrod. Who's Nimrod? Nimrod, the Bible, according to the scripture, is, you go home and read these scriptures. Nimrod is a man hunter. The Bible says he's a hunter before the Lord. But the difference with him, he was a man hunter. So what he did was he hunted people who could stand with him to fulfill his vision, but his vision was not from God. So he's a man hunter. So we've got to be careful of man hunters. People that come into the ministry looking for people to fulfill their own agendas. Come on. They're trying to get people around. You'll find out the birds of a feather flock together. So when people have their own agenda, they have their own vision. And if there's two, anything that has two heads is a beast. That's why the church must have one head. And anything in the kingdom of God that has two visions is division. So we've got to come to this place of having one vision. One head, one vision. And when we understand that, we understand that we are the body. We are here to fulfill the desires of the head. Why? You ever realize how come God put the eyes in the head? Come on, think about it. Because the head has the vision. God says to Abraham, look now from where you are. Look up, look down, look side. Wherever you look, I've given it to you. You ever thought why God put the nose in the head? Because the man of God has to have the spirit of discernment. To discern. To smell the coffee. You ever thought why God put the ears in the head? So that he'd be able to hear from God. And not from all the people and their opinions. You gotta see this. Because God put the mouth there so that he'd speak the word. He'd speak what God is saying to him. That's why Elijah comes to his servant. He says to his servant, go and see if you can find what I heard. Go and see if you can find what I heard. Because I heard it, you go and see it. And I think in the kingdom of God, we need leaders and we need people that will see what we heard. And just because you can't see what we heard, we're not going to change the sermon. We're going to preach what God's caused us to preach. And we're going to preach it until you see it. In 2004, the Lord told me he's going to give me the building where we are now. He's going to give us the extension of the building. And I called my leaders and I said to them, this is what God said to me. They looked, what are you talking about? I said, God said he's going to give us the building. They said, what are you talking about? So 3 years went by and the Lord had blessed me with a beautiful car worth a lot of money. And the Lord said to me, sell the car now and put the money in the building fund. I said, that's a bad thing to do. We can bind the devil, you know that, when things like that happen. And then I said to my wife, I said, this is what God wanted me to do. So I put the money in 2009, 100,000 rand. That's a lot of money there in Chatsworth for a young pastor to put. Yes, I'm still young. So I put the money in, and everyone's looking, what did you do? I said, I put my money in there, in the building fund, because God said, I'm going to get it. The question the Lord asked me, if you want the people to believe in your vision, do you believe in the vision I've given you? If you believe in it, sow for it. I sowed in 2009, but the Lord only gave me the property this year. When nobody believed me. Can you imagine Noah preaching every day, trying to get people to build the ark, but also believe in what they're building? He employed the people who didn't believe him to build what God told him, and paid them to build it every day for 120 years, and nobody came into the ark because they built what they didn't believe. And that's why ministry is a tough go. You got to see what God's telling us. And unless you see it, it will not manifest. It can't manifest. So when the Lord gave me the property, he said to me, he'll take care of the need. And you know what? We bought the property cash. Cash in 15 days. Come on, talk to me. Your bishop has been to Durban. In Durban, there is no land for churches. The only thing the church has got to do now to build themselves up is to buy corporate properties and convert it to churches. So we bought a shopping complex. And we're busy buying all of them off. I'm busy buying a surgery off in the complex. Because God's given us a big vision. But what I'm saying to you is that in all this, we've got to hear what God is saying. You've got to be tuned. Tune your antennas to what God is saying. Can you imagine Abraham if he didn't be obedient and hear the voice of God? God said to him, take Isaac, put him on the altar. And then God said, I'm provided a ram. Don't kill him. Amen. Come on, talk to me. Can I ask you a question? At which point did God stop him? When he had the knife there? He's got to hear God's voice. Because he could easily speak in tongues and bind the devil for stopping him from killing Isaac. Because God said, go to the mountain and sacrifice Isaac. So now he's got Isaac on the altar and Abraham is ready to strike him. And then the Bible says God stopped him. Now how did he know that God stopped him and not the devil stopping him? He's got to know the voice of God. Tell your neighbor, you got to know the voice of God. Come on, tell your neighbor, you got to know the voice of God. You got to learn, church, you got to learn to tune into the voice of God. You got to know when God is speaking, and you got to know when I want to ask you, why is the devil speaking to you? why is the devil speaking to you when you've got so much of God? You've got so much of God. Why are you letting the devil speak to you? So you shouldn't even know his voice. You should know the voice of the Father. You should know the voice of God. Come on, you should know his voice. So when we understand where Abraham is, he's in Babel. But we can't take it from Babel because Babel was just another confused place and a place of babbling. So we've got to go back. We go to Noah. So we can't really start from Noah because Noah came before the flood and he had the flood. And then God made a covenant with Noah. So we can't take it from Noah. We've got to go right back to Genesis. And today we're starting at Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. Tell everybody, we're starting in the beginning. See, if you want to know the intent of God, you've got to start from the beginning. And Genesis 1 tells us, in the beginning, God created the, come on, heaven and the, and the earth was without and void. And darkness was upon the face of the, and the Spirit of the Lord. So God can move even in the midst of darkness. Wow. So God can move irrespective of chaos. So there are a lot of people having chaos, but God is still moving. He's not going to stop because people are in chaos and darkness. So in the midst of a house that's in turmoil, God can still move and speak. Come on. So we find that in the book of Genesis, there is void, darkness, and chaos. Come on. There's void, darkness, and chaos. And the Bible says, and the Spirit of the Lord moved. Now, whenever God moves, the next thing he does is he speaks. Verse number 3 tells us. Let's go, sir. Where's our man? Okay. Genesis chapter 1, verse 3. Then God, come on. So the Spirit of God moved. And then when the Spirit of God moves, then he speaks. How many of you are trusting God to move this weekend? Well, he's already moving and he's already speaking. Come on now. He's moving and he's speaking. So God said, let there be light. Now, whenever the light is switched on, that means there's something to be revealed. Thy word is entrance. It is light. Revelation means illumination. Come on. Illumination of something. If we switch the lights off here now, for those of you who have not been here for a long time, you will not find your way through. But the others have fashioned their way. They have traditionalized their seat. They know exactly where it is, how many benches and how many steps from the door, where they're sitting, and they always sit there and never move. They sing that lovely song that we sing in Durban, I shall not be moved. And yet God is moving. So God is moving, but they won't be moved. There are some believers who will sit in church for many years and nothing will move them. Not even God. So here we go. He says, then God said, let there be light. And there was light. You and I have been created in the image of, come on. So God has given us a level of his capacity. Not all. He has given us, we are not omnipotent. We are not omniscient. Come on. We have certain attributes of God that is given to us, but he's not given us all. Come on. The Bible says there's life and death in the power of the tongue. What you're not speaking, you're not getting. What you're not speaking, you'll never have. Because life and death in the power of the tongue. You keep confessing cancer will take your life. But if you keep confessing, I am healed in the name of Jesus, then you shall be. Oh, come on, am I talking to the church tonight? Come on. So he says, let there be light, and there was light. The things that you are not calling forth are things that are not appearing. Romans 4:17 tells us, and call those things that are not as though they were. The level of faith is, I've got to see in the spirit what I want manifest in the physical. Faith is the substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. What I have to do is see it in the physical form, in the spirit, before it manifests in front of me. When your faith fails you, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, see that your hope kicks in to save you. You should write that down. That's a life principle. When you lose your faith, don't lose your hope. So, God said, let there be, and there was. God said, let there be, and there was. Why are we going to Genesis? Because we got to go to see what God, what is God's intent? God doesn't have a plan B. What is God's intent? Let's go to verse number 4. And God saw the light that it was. Come on. And God saw the light that it was. So whenever God creates anything, he sees the goodness in his creation. Come on. So whenever you read scripture, you'll find out God said, let there be, and there was. Now, Hebrews 11:3 tells us that God framed the world by the words of his mouth. Framed the world by the words of his mouth. Now, the words there, God framed it. If you don't really understand scripture, you'll misunderstand it. Because anything that is framed cannot be altered. You take a picture. You can't alter it. Why? It's already been taken. All right? You're partly cloudy. It's winter. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. So God says, I knew you before you came here. Come on. So, a 16-year-old baby that is here has seed within herself that will come when she gets married. Come on. But God says, I know what's in your womb that's going to come. So just because you can't see it doesn't mean it's non-existent. Before I formed you, so your form only takes place when you come down. All right, let's go this way. I can see what's happening. You're making me to work. It's Friday night. It's fine. I've traveled. There are some people you walk into the mall and you see them, you greet them, and you walk past. There are some people you meet in the mall, but you don't greet them, you just walk past them. You don't know who they are. You've never seen them before. There are some people you walk up. I know you from somewhere. Where did I meet you? Do I know your parents? Where do you live? Because I know you from somewhere. And there are some people you meet, you can stand for an hour and talk to them without any doubt because you know them. Right. Now watch this. There are some people up there you never meet. Before you were formed, you knew them. See, Mercy and Dr. Philip were there before they came here. Okay, let's put it this way. You meet a few girls that you date, but you never marry all of them. Some people walk into your life and they stay for a few minutes. Some people walk into your life and they stay for a day. Some people walk into your life and they stay for a season. Some people walk till death us do part. Because before you were formed, I'm trying to show you something. That praise and worship is not something that you do here because you're coming for an event. It is what you've been doing there before you came here. So here is an extension of what I was doing there. Okay. Age and mortality. This is deep for you, I know. Age and mortality only kicked in when Adam fell. So Adam is created not a baby. Adam is created a perfect man. Okay, let me go. You'll catch me. I can see where you are. Let's go to verse number 9. So you understand. Okay, let me help you. You realize in scripture that God creates a whole lot of things before he creates the sun. Because he didn't need the sun to sustain everything. Science teaches us that without the sun, there'll be non-existence. But if you read the Bible, things existed before the sun came. God said, let there be light before he created the sun. The sun is not the source of your light. Oh, man, come on, help me now. You guys need to read your Bible. Simple, just read. Now, watch this. God said, let the waters appear, and the waters were so. Go to verse number 9. Go to verse number 9. I'm going fast. We got a track. We haven't got much time. Okay, I'm South African time, so you better stop me. Huh? And we're 7 hours behind. In fact, I redeemed my time. Right. Then God said, let the waters... Now go to verse 9. Is that 9? Okay, go to 10. Go to 10, the next one. Go to 10. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together the waters, he called them, seas. And God saw that it was... Can you see this? Whenever God is creating things, he's calling it good. Right, let's go to verse number 11. Then God said, let the earth bring forth grass. Go to verse 12. And the earth brought forth. You got to see this ability that you're not operating in. See, here, let me explain to you something. I said to the church, I'm going to the States. I'm going to honor my pledge with Dr. Sunny Phillips because I gave him my word. And within 3 days, the ticket was bought. I didn't have the money for the ticket. I confessed something. I didn't say I'm thinking about going. I am going. What you're not speaking is not being. The widow that Elijah went to, the widow. The first thing he asked the widow was, fetch me some water. Why was he asking the widow for water? No. He can't be thirsty because if you find out, when you read the scripture, he never gets the water. So he wasn't thirsty. He was checking his divine connection. His brook just dried up. Oh, come on now. His brook dried up. And the Lord said to him, I've commanded a widow in Zarephath to take care of you. I think you guys sometimes think the widow's name, her surname was Zarephath. Zarephath was the name of a place. What's the name of your place here? What's it? Valley Stream. Bishop Sunny Phillips, I've commanded a widow in Durban to take care of you. Go. Durban is the name of a place. Zarephath is the name of a place. How is he going to find the widow in Durban? There are many widows in Durban. How is he going to find her? There has to be a divine connection. So when Elijah goes there, the first thing he meets, because the Bible doesn't tell us how many he met, he asks her for water. Why? Because the widow who's going to take care of him must have water. She must have water. Why? Because his water dried up. And then God said, I've commanded. So when he goes there, she goes for the water. Elijah says, fetch me some bread, cake. Okay, chapati. Fetch me some cake. She says, I have a little, I have a handful, and I have not. Uh-huh. A language is, I am about to die. What she is speaking is going to haunt her down the line. Elijah says to her, make for me first. The flour won't run out. The oil won't run out. Neither will the water run out. Why? Because the language was, me and my son are going to eat this cake and we're going to die. Elijah takes her from not enough to more than enough. Why? By the words of her mouth. You are living now what you spoke yesterday. And if you want to live tomorrow better, you've got to change what you speak today. Because what you're not speaking, you will not live. Let me help you. You are living in now what you sowed yesterday. If you want to change your living, you've got to change your sowing. Oh, man, come on. Come on, help me here. Come on, somebody help me. You've got to change it. If you... you're reaping, change your sowing. Got to learn to change it. Why? What you're speaking is what you're going to have. What you're not getting is what you're not speaking. Because the words were framed by the words of God. Now, go to Acts chapter 17, verse 24. Acts 17, verse 24. I like this big screen because we can all see together, because I see some of you don't have your Bibles. I know you, thy word have I hid in my heart. I know you guys. Okay, Acts 17, 24. God, okay, watch this. God, who had made the world and everything in it. God who made the world and everything in it. He made everything. Don't you ever be fooled. He made. Okay. Okay, let's go to verse 25. He's not worshipped with hands, men's hands, as though he needed anything. God doesn't need anything from you. Go to verse 26. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the... Everyone's dying to go to heaven. God says, I've given you the earth. I'm not talking finances this weekend, but I'll blow your mind concerning finances. The church is lagging behind because the church doesn't want the money. It's not a prosperity gospel. It's a God who prospers. And the church in America has missed it big time. That's when the economic crunch hit the world, America felt the pinch. But we in Durban didn't feel the pinch because we don't operate on the earth. We operate in kingdom. When you operate in kingdom power, you'll be sustained by the kingdom and not by man. You must go and read your book of Genesis on Joseph. Maybe I'll teach you some stuff on Joseph. Joseph controlled the whole economy of the world. The Bible says every nation went to Joseph. And Joseph knew how to articulate the money. What we need in the kingdom of God now is some Josephs in the house who knows how to articulate the money. The end time move of God is going to be an end time move of souls and money. The kingdom cannot be run without finances. Why am I talking money? Stop it. You guys are pulling this thing from me. And I promise you, if you pull it, you'll get it on Sunday. Right. He had made all nations. So whether you cut a Hispanic person, whether you cut a Chinese or a Japanese or a black American, a black South African or an Indian, all have red blood. Hey, you can be as white as snow. When we cut you up, red blood flows out. Because God has made all nations with one blood. The pigmentations will be slightly different, but all have red blood. Right, now watch this. To dwell on the face of the... To dwell where? I mean, we've been singing songs like, I'm on my way to Canaan's land. I can't wait to get to heaven. My God, God put us here to... God put us here to enjoy the earth. You know why you guys are not living the kingdom wealth inheritance? Okay, let's ask you a simple question. Is it okay if I ask you a question? Is it okay if I ask you a question? Where did God put the gold? I mean, we're talking about heaven's got streets paved with gold. Now, come on. Heaven's got streets paved with gold. So you're looking to go to heaven where there's gold. Open to Genesis chapter 2, verse number 10, sir. Genesis 2:10. Now a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it parted and became four river heads. I want to teach you the next time I come, we'll do a finance conference for you. I want to teach you how to have four streams of income. Now you're shocked. There were four. Come on, talk to me. And it parted and became four river heads. From one stream became four. How do you guys survive on one income? Do you have more days than money? Or you don't? So you guys don't know how to live debt-free? Everything maybe must be mortgaged. But the Bible says you should owe no man So what Bible are you reading? The KJV, Russian Bible? You guys must read your Bible and live by the. No, it's too holy. And we shouldn't be talking about money in the church. And it became four heads. Now go to verse number 11. The name of the first one is not poison. Not poison. And it's very close to poison. It is the one which skirts the whole land of Avila where there is. Why will God put Adam in the garden and tell him this river that leads from the garden will split up in four, and the one that's the first one you follow, you'll find the gold. Let me help you. Go to the next verse. And the gold of that land is good. Everything that God created, he said it was. After his creation, we're in chapter 2 now. We're in chapter 2. Cain and Abel are on the earth now. And God says there is gold. And he says the gold is good. And you don't want it? You guys don't want it? He says, hold on. There's beryllium stone, the onyx stones, they're all there. But you don't want it. You know, in South Africa, there was a mining magnate. It's called Brett Kebble. He's late. He died. He staged his own death. He had himself shot, hired people to shoot him, because he controlled all the mines in South Africa. He was called the mining magnate of South Africa. Staged his own death to claim insurance because he was left penniless. All because he doesn't know how to control the gold that God gave him. Because he wasn't a believer. God is releasing. The Bible says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. I don't know if there's any just people in this house. And if it's laid up for you, I'll tell the church this. The Amplified Version says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. But if you in the church and behave wicked and unrighteous, then your money is going to someone else. It's easy to quote it and live unrighteously and think it's going to stay. It's going to go. It's going to go. Now, why did we get to money? Because I didn't come to talk about money. Now, watch this. So God placed everything and he said it was good. Now, go to verse number 26. Genesis 1:26. Then God said, let us make man. Go to verse 27. Did you see this? Did you see the words dominion there? Come on, God gave man dominion over the fish, over the beast, and over the fowls. Can I tell you quickly what those three things mean? He said, let's have control over or have dominion over the fish of the sea. The fish of the sea speaks about the spirit world. Water. Water speaks of spirit. So he said, you must have dominion over the spirit world, or the spirit world will have dominion over you. Quickly, I'll give you. Then he says, you should have dominion over the beast of the field. The beast of the field speaks about the passions of man. If you don't control the lusts in your flesh, the lust in the flesh will control you. That's a deep one. Then he says, you shall have control over the birds of the, dominion over the birds of the air. The birds of the air speaks about your head. Because the Bible says in the book of Genesis, Joseph interprets the butler and the baker's dream. The baker says he had cookies on his head, and the birds of the air came and ate it. Matthew chapter 13 tells us that some seeds fell on good ground, some fields seeds fell on rocky ground, some fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and ate up the seed. To eat up the seed means to have compelling thoughts. Compelling thoughts are thoughts that come after you hear a faith word. Compelling thoughts rob you. Birds of the air. They rob you of what God is. You can hear a word of faith tonight. Go out of this meeting all excited because God gave you a word that you're going to get the dream or you're going to get some fulfillment. something, God's going to send something for you, God's going to open a door for you. You walk out and somebody tells you, you think you're going to get that door open, you think it's going to work out for you. You have a compelling thought. That's why Romans 12 says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him, which is your reasonable. And be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. What's holding me back? My mind. You can't outthink God. You can't outthink God. That's why you got to think big. See, when Joseph's brothers got to Joseph and they took out his coat, the coat was an outward appearance. It was just a mantle that he had on it. But he had the dream on the inside. So they took the coat, and this is what they said in Genesis 37, 18, 19. It says, let us kill this dreamer, and we will see what will happen to his dream. What they didn't realize, the dream is on the inside, not on the coat. Right, so God created the male and female. Verse number 28, sir. You got to go fast. Then God, come on, God, bless them. What did he say? Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over it. 29. We're going faster. And God said, see, I have given you everything. Verse 30, sir. Also the beast of the field, watch this, everything. Food for everything, all the different types of food. Verse number 31. Then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was. Now, come on now, talk to me. So when God created everything, come on, he took 5 days to create everything. Do you guys read your Bible? Hoping for me to read it? 5 days he creates everything that man will need. He creates man on the 6th day so man will come without need. So when man is created on the 6th day, man has everything that he will need created before he comes. So your resources are in your future. God created you without need. Come on now, talk to me. So when God places you here, your needs are already there. That's why when Abraham is walking and going to Mount Moriah, the ram is already there. Where is the ram? It's already there. Why? The ram wants to run down, but God caught the ram in the thicket. He said, when Abraham comes here, his need will be there. Your needs are in your future. God has already provided for you. He has blessed you. God has blessed you. Come on, now watch this. So, and God said it was very good. Now watch this. Watch the stage. Everything that God created in 5 days, he said it was good. On the 6th day, he creates man, and then he puts man in good. And now God looks at it and says, you got to see this. You got to see this. So 5 days, God creates everything that man will need. Everything that man will need was created before he came. On the 6th day, which is the number for man, God creates man on the 6th day and places man in good and looks at the whole thing and says, now it is very good because I've got someone to use everything that I've created. Watch this. Let's go to chapter number 2, verse number 1. Thus the heavens and the earth and all. Come on, you got to read with me. Read with me. There's no trick there. It's a scripture. Can we do the KJV? Maybe they'll get a better understand. Here we go. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished. And all the... But your Bible said God only created Adam and Eve. How did he finish the host of them? That's you and I. Come on. He framed the whole world by the words of his mouth. If you take yourself out from there, then you are missing something. He framed the whole world by the words of his mouth. God already created you long before you arrived here. Because you were with him before you were formed. Is this your Bible? Now come on, help me. Is this your Bible? Thus the heavens and the earth were. So the finishing of the heavens and earth is unfinished if you take yourself out. And all the host of them. You are a host there. You were finished there in Genesis. Tell your neighbor, I was finished there in Genesis. Don't you ever forget that. Don't you ever forget that. Now watch this. Go to verse number 2. And on the God which he had, and he, I told you before, he rested because he was, because he finished his work, the Bible says. Hey, this is deep for you, man. Is this too much for you? Should I close and come back in the morning? You'll be fresh. Now watch this. And he rested from all his, which he had. Okay, stop right there. Stop right there. Go to John chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. John chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. In the beginning, and the Word was, and the Word was, the same was in the beginning with, all things were made, and without him was not anything made that was. Who made everything? So you think you were made separately? Go to Colossians 1:15 and 16. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? Who's that? Jesus. I showed you in John, in the beginning was the Word. He was there. Go to verse number, For by him, hold on. So you were created for who? No, you were created for who? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and. So you were created by him. Now go to Genesis chapter 2, verse number 3. You got to have a picture of these scriptures before you come to that one. That's why I'm taking you there. And God blessed the. I think you missed it. I said all I wanted to say to come to this one. And God blessed the. Okay, let me go again. 5 days he creates everything. And he calls it. On the 6th day he creates man. Places him in. Good, and says it is. On the 7th day, why is he blessing the 7th day? Okay, let me help you. Man is here in the 6th day. I'm on the stage, right? Man is here on the stage. The stage is the line. 5 days, 6 day, man is created, placed in the garden. With good, and he's called very good because he came on the scene. Tell him, but you're a good thing. I think sometimes you forget that. Now watch this. He creates everything, places man in what he creates, and says it is very good. Man is not a baby. Man is not created a baby. Man is created a perfect man. So Adam is created on the 6th day, but God blesses the, some of you got it. Okay, let's go this side. God creates everything that Adam will need 5 days before he arrives. On the 6th day, he creates Adam and puts him in what he will need. So Adam will be without need, but God blessed the 7th day. Right? Maybe I should go on the stage and show you this because you still can't get it. Adam is created on the 6th day. Adam's 1st day still didn't get it. You still didn't get it? If I was in Nigeria preaching this word, they would be running to the front throwing money at me. I'm serious. And I want to go there and preach this word to them. 6 days. Man is finished. He's looking very good in what God had created good for him. But without him, it's only good. But there, everything is very good. Come on, you got to catch this. And then God blessed man's first day. The seventh day for God is man's first day. So man, when he walks into his first day, it's a blessed day. So that he will walk out of the garden, out of need. He doesn't have need because God created everything that he will need. But God blessed his day because man is not a baby waiting for a walking ring. Man is not in a pram. He's a full-grown man. So when man walks and steps into the seventh day, it is his first day. What's God's seventh day? Seven speaks of completion. Speaks of perfection. So when man walks out of the garden, he walks into the blessings of God. You don't look for blessings. You're supposed to walk into blessings. God is not looking. I've heard this being said that God is looking for somebody to bless them. God is not looking to bless you. You have to learn to walk into the blessing because God has got it for you. The day you arrive here is you are blessed because God has blessed you already. I don't go looking for blessings. I am a blessing because God has already blessed me. I learn to walk into. So when you understand what you're walking into, I don't walk because I have a need. God has already blessed my walk, man. Come on. My days are blessed. Come on. My days are blessed. It's blessed. God has already blessed me. So whatever you need, I've got to articulate by faith. I've got to activate it by faith. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. So I've got to activate it by faith. So when you study Abraham, you've got to study Abraham from the backdrop that Abraham is the father of faith. So when man failed, now watch this. God said to him, come on, Genesis 1:27, God said, be fruitful, multiply, have dominion, subdue. Now man began to multiply in the earth until we come to a place in the book of Genesis chapter 9, and the Bible says, and man became fruitful. No, man multiplied. Man was not fruitful, but man multiplied. There's a big difference. The fruitfulness that man's supposed to multiply was good. The Bible says in Acts 10:38 that Jesus was anointed to go around doing good. Come on, doing good. So man was supposed to take what was good and replenish the earth. He was supposed to be fruitful and multiply good. But the Bible says in the book of Genesis chapter 9 that God repented that he had made man. Because man multiplied out of fruitfulness. He was supposed to multiply in fruitfulness. But he multiplied out of fruitfulness. Fruitfulness was, he was supposed to multiply and become fruitful in good. Because the first sons that are born, Cain and Abel, they got murder spirit in them. So that's not good. Why? Because, you see this, you got to see this. Adam didn't have Cain and Abel in good. He was banished from good. So when he was banished from the garden, he had Cain and Abel outside the garden. So when Cain and Abel is born, it repented God by chapter 9. Look at only a few chapters and God says it repented that he had made man. Can you see this? So what God is trying to do, he's trying to redeem now. He wants to destroy. He wants to destroy. He said, Adam, when Adam comes out from the ark, you know, he sends a dove and all those have significance. And then Noah. Noah sends the dove out of the ark. It comes back. And then the second one comes back with the olive branch. All of them have different significance because the opening of the window is an important commodity for the principle in which the church has to walk, the dimension of the church. Because there's a window, and you'll find that the ark didn't have windows facing the earth or the side. It had the window facing the top. And by the time you come to Malachi, the window's facing you. So you understand these principles that the opening of the window was that Noah had to see if God had done something. He can't look down at the earth because the waters were still on the earth. He's got to look up to see what's happening down. In order to walk this earth, you've got to learn to look up to know what's happening down. See, you're not going to find the answers of the earth on the earth. You've got to find the answers of the earth to God. You've got to go to the manufacturer. You've got to go back to the source. Can I say you something? If God is your source, you'll never fail. But if your boss is the source, or your company, or your business is the source, then you're going to fail. So you've got to know who's your source. So when Noah comes on the scene, God wants to bring Noah into this ark because the people were... The Bible says that it repented God that the imagination of man had been so thwarted. And man was looking at sin all the time, and God said, I've got to do something with this. So when God destroys the earth, we find that Noah found grace in the sight of the Lord. Come on, Noah finds grace in the sight of the Lord. And then we come to the Tower of Babel where Abraham now is in the system. Say system. Come on, the system. What is the system? The Babylonian system. Babel is Babylonian. Come on, we get the Tower of Babel. The Babylonians are out of the system. What was Nebuchadnezzar's job in Babylon? Come on. He chose young boys. Come on. Who were skillful and cunning in science, who knew astrology. They were astronauts, astronomers. And the Bible says he chose them to teach them the language. What was Babel? Babel had one language. What is Nebuchadnezzar's job? Is to get everyone to understand his language. And the Bible says he gave them positions in the government. You'll find out if you come to people and give them government jobs, they're happy. They won't complain. Come on. So position minded, we become, even the church, become position. You give a person a position in the church, they become highly minded. Why? Because now they've got a position. If you don't give them position, then bulls' horns come out. You ever thought a person sitting in the church, what a wonderful person sitting there worshiping the Lord, so faithful to the church, and the moment that you don't give them the position, then they had angels' wings when they were worshiping, all of a sudden devil horns come out. Now, don't laugh. I'm talking about you. Because the moment you don't give them the position, then they... Okay, think about it. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The lady sang the song. You guys confirmed everything I needed to preach. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were not the real names. Those were the names given to them by Babylon. The real names were Anani, Mishael, and Azariah. What do the real names mean? Who God is, whom God helps, and what God is. What did they change the names to? Shadrach means no sense of belonging. When identity is questioned, unbelief is born. When you don't know who you are, you'll do everything that is not in your purpose. Come on. So when you understand why Nebuchadnezzar changed the names, you'll understand because he wanted them not to be. See, Judah, Israel had a very significant thing in naming people. Jabez was born because his mother bore him in pain. And his mother named him Pain because she bore him in pain. When Benjamin was being born, his mother named him Benoni. Son of my sorrow. But Jacob came and renamed him to Benjamin, son of my right hand. He changed because then renaming changed the course of his destiny. When God meets Abram, he's Abram. And then God says, your name will no more be called Abram, but your name will be called Abraham. And your wife will no more be called Sarah, but Sarah. God changes things because he's causing the destiny of them. And I declare over your life that your name will be changed, that God will meet with you, that you'll have an encounter with God. Jacob encountered God at Bethel, and it was called the gateway. He said, this is the gateway to heaven. Because when you have an encounter with God, then God begins to reveal his gateway to you. See, without the presence of God, you'll never understand the power of God. And without the power of God, you'll never fulfill the purpose. So you've got to come to this place of encountering God. And I think the church has missed this encounter. And God is longing for his church. to have that encounter. Lamentations 3:19 tells us, I cried for my lovers, but they didn't hear me. He says, I longed for my elders, but they turned a deaf ear. God is longing for his church. In fact, when Moses cries to God in Exodus 33:15, he says to God, show me your glory. God says, I can't share my glory with men. He says, you will see my underparts. You'll see the back of me. What is the back of God? If God has no beginning and end, what is the back of God? How can Moses write the book of Genesis and he wasn't there? Because God had to show him what he had already done. Moses is the only one who wrote about his own death before he died. Ah, oh, come on. You gotta see God's unfolding. God is in everything that you do. And if you divorce God from what you do, you're gonna divorce this life into death and hell. Because there's only one way. So Abraham comes onto the scene because Babel wants to control him. What does Babel want to do? Nimrod, the Nimrod spirit. You've got to be careful of the Nimrod spirit in the church. Because the Nimrod spirit is trying to get people to solicit the support and to drive them away from what God's purposed them to do. So Nimrod is to draw people to fulfill own agenda and to fund the agenda. Because Nimrod got them to buy into the plan. To buy into this thing. And what they were doing. See, they were wasting time, wasting money, building a tower they'll never reach heaven. So Nimrod's job was to get them to waste their energy, waste the time, and waste the money. So you get wasteful spending, but you don't get the output. It's like going to work and earning money and putting pockets with holes. Agai talks about it. It's like having more days than money. Always in debt, always in need. And God has created you without need because he created your need before you arrived. Come on. He's created what you will need before you came here. So you will walk into your blessed day because you'll walk without need. Come on. God has blessed you already. You got to fall into line with what God has for you. Many people are trying to find the feet. Come on. Don't try to find your feet. Find God. It's easier. And then you'll find your feet. So we got to come to the space of understanding where Abraham is. And Abraham is the father of faith. So God comes to Abraham after his father, Terah. Terah is dead in chapter number 11, the last verse. Terah died. Where did he die? He died in a place called Aaron. What was Aaron? Aaron was the media center. Aaron was the center point. It was the cross border for trade. When he came from Mesopotamia, he came to Aaron. And the Bible says his father Terah dies there because Aaron reminded him of his son named Aaron, who was Lot's father. So what is he doing? He's sitting in Aaron and crying over Lot's father, whose name is Aaron, and he's remembering what he lost, and he's crying there, and he dies there. God doesn't want you to die in your pain and your sorrow and your memories of yesterday. God has a future for you, and God wants to take you to the brighter place. And that's why God has to come. You got to see scripture because God comes to Abraham now. He says, get thee out of that place. And if you read it too passively, you'll miss it. God, talk to me. When you want to talk to your child or somebody to get a message across, there's a real force. Get out of my sight. Get to your room. Come on. Get to school or go. There's a force. Your child or whoever you're talking to understands the power behind what you're saying. Because you're saying it with force and you mean what you say. God is saying to Abraham, because Abraham has become too comfortable in Aaron, he says, get out of that system. Get out of that country. Get out of that kindred. Get that thing out because I'm about to take you into a journey that God has a plan for him. God says, I'm going to take you into a place your eye has not seen it. He says, unto a land that I will show you. That means he can't see it himself. God's going to show him. Say, show me, Lord. How many of you believe God's going to do that for you? I'm about 5 minutes. Yeah, are we right? 5 minutes? I've got five minutes. Now, Abraham, the Bible says in chapter 12, verse number 4, Abraham departed. Come on. Abraham departed. So God spoke to him. Abraham departed. When we look at the word departed, Abraham departed, we've got to look at it from this backdrop. Abraham is the father of faith. God speaks to him. Abraham departs. What is Abraham leaving behind? What happened in Genesis? Come on now, you got to go back. What happened in Genesis? In the beginning? Come on. So God comes to Abraham, now he starts in the beginning. Okay? Okay, you'll catch it. Void, darkness, in the beginning. And God says, let there be. Abraham is in Nimrod, Babylon. Darkness, void, chaos. Chaos. They're building things, they're doing things, they're having success doing the wrong thing. And God comes and says, the ways of man is one and his language is one and nothing will restrain him. And God says, Abraham, get out of there. Come on. He takes him out of chaos. See, God is trying to take you out of something. God is trying to pull you out of chaos. You still want to go to the miserable chaotic place. God is trying to take you out of something. God is trying to pull you out of system. You still wanna be in the government system because you don't want to work. You want the government to support you and to give you social grant and whatever. And God says, I've blessed you. You don't need any man to bless you. I'm your source. I will bless you. He's already blessed you. So he says to Abraham, get out of that place. For God to say somebody to get out of the place, he's not happy where you are. Tell your neighbor, God's not happy where you are. You see, because we become content where we are. Because the word of God is non-effective through our traditions. Come on now, we're going back. The word of God has traditionalized us. We're so used to this. God's not going to do it this way. And we become traditional. So we don't operate in faith. Hebrews 4:2 tells us that the word preached to them profited them nothing. And the word preached to us will profit us nothing if the word is not mingled with faith. So the word of God must be mingled with faith to be profitable in our life. So when Abraham is pulled out of a system, he's pulled out of a system because he's got to go on a journey, but he's got to be obedient to God. That's what the Bible says. And Abraham looked for a place. Come on, he looked for a place. Whose master builder was. Come on. What is he doing? Looking towards God, who's the creator, who's the source of all things. And the Bible says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Would you stand with me? Come on, let's stand. Let's stand. Let's pray. Come on, let's just pray. Come on, give God praise. Come on. Let me help you. Let me help you. You see, the church, I'm not talking about you now. I'm talking about the church. The church expects a revival. And the expectance of revival is that somebody must lay hands on you, you'll fall down and wake up and be the same. No. Hear me. That's a revival for a church. I'm not talking about your pastor and you now. The concept of revival throughout Africa is that somebody will lay hands on them, they'll fall down, get up, the power of God will move in the place and they'll be changed. No, you will only be changed by the preaching of the word. And if you mix and mingle the word with faith, it will change your life. So I don't know about you, but I'm not one to wake up and be the same. No. I want to change according to the word. Imagine if you took the word and lived the word. Just imagine. What a life you'll have. So we're not living the word. And my job as the end time preacher is to preach the word and nothing but the word. So people will get the word, get the anointing. After you got the word, you can fall down, wake up, and you will be changed. But without the word, see, if you have the anointing without the word, you can have the word without the anointing. But if you have both, think about it. If you have the word without the anointing, you'll dry up. If you have the word without the anointing, you'll blow up. But if you have the word and the anointing, you'll grow up. And it's time the church grew up. The greatest revival that can ever happen in your heart is to live by the word of God. Come on, is to walk the word of God. So I want you to worship him now. Come on, I want you to worship him. Lift up your voices and worship him. Come on, lift up your voices and worship him. Come on, I want you to lift up your voices and worship him. Come on, I want you to lift up your voices and worship him. Yes, just acknowledge him. Come on. Come on, enthrone him. Glorify him. Come on, someone lift him up. Lift him up. Lift him up. Yes, just lift him up. Come on, enthrone him. Glorify him. Come on, somebody magnify him. Tell him how big he is. Tell him how great he is.